ZOE is an app that uses a personalized diet. So the idea is you undergo a number of tests, blood work, and others. And based on that, they design a diet that is tailored for you, for your physiology. ZOE was co-founded by Tim Spector, who is a professor at King's College London. And it's gotten a lot of press, a lot of attention in mainstream media. So they actually ran a randomized trial using the ZOE protocol to see if it works, if it gives any benefit. And that was actually just published last week. So first of all, I think it's great that they actually ran a trial to test it. I think this should be step one. If you're selling a diet or an app or a product, show me that it works. That's ground zero, right? Show me that there's some science backing it up. It's actually been tested. In reality, this is the exception to the rule. Most apps, most websites, most products out there are not tested scientifically. And they're sold on the back of things like testimonials, which are close to meaningless. So the fact that these guys actually went out of their way and ran a trial, I think is really good. Now, ZOE funded the trial. So in a way, you have the same company being evaluated by this trial and paying for it, which is a question you guys frequently ask me, this question of funding of studies, funding of science. And it's true that a lot of people reacted to this study dismissively, kind of poo-pooing this as an industry-funded study. But I think this is an interesting example of how we should think about this question in general. So we'll come back to this in a second. All right, so what did the trial find? They took their participants around 300 or so, so it's a decent scale trial, and they split them randomly between the ZOE group, the group that went through the ZOE protocol, and a control group. And the group getting the ZOE treatment did see a number of benefits. Their triglyceride level came down, their body weight and their hemoglobin A1C were all reduced over the course of the trial, which lasted 18 weeks. And they also reported improvements in energy level, sleep quality, and mood in general. There was also a suggestion that their microbiome may have improved, may have become more diverse and more enriched in bacterial species that are generally associated with positive health outcomes. Other metrics like ApoB, LDL cholesterol, blood pressure were not significantly affected. Although when they looked specifically at the subset of participants that had the highest adherence, so that stuck more faithfully to the recommendations, they did see a suggestion of a benefit in those people. Now, some of the changes are towards the small side, unclear if they're clinically significant, but in general, pretty clear trend towards a positive change in the individuals undergoing the ZOE program compared to controls. The main limitation, the main problem with the trial, which a lot of people pointed this out on social media, and I agree with this criticism, is that the control group received a lot less interaction and resources. Basically, the control group got a leaflet in the beginning of the trial with some general information about what a healthy diet is, essentially the USDA guidelines. They also got a link to a video covering that same information, but in video format. Other than that, they had access to some online information that they could consult if they wanted to. And once a week, they got an email from one of the coaches on the team to check in with them. The ZOE group, on the other hand, got a lot more stuff. They started by going through a battery of tests, including blood work, and also wearing a CGM, a continuous glucose monitor, for 2 weeks. Then for 4 weeks, they received interactive lessons on the ZOE app, covering basic healthy nutrition concepts, things like diversifying a diet, including fruits and vegetables and fiber-containing foods in your diet, fermented foods, replacing refined grains with whole grains, pretty general concepts. Then, after those initial 4 weeks, they received a personalized report going over their results, their blood sugar levels, their triglycerides, their microbiome analyses, so kind of a panel of their physiological metrics. Based on those metrics and a little bit their history, the ZOE crew, based on an algorithm, came up with a personalized diet plan for each of the participants. So then the participants had a one-on-one session with a coach, one of the staff on team, to go over their results and to go over a little bit the personalized plan for them. Then for the next 12 weeks of the program, they continued to receive lessons on the app, going over their personalized diet plan and strategies to adhere to that plan. They could also contact the coaches via the app at any time. And they also had to log all their food intake on at least 4 days out of the month. So average one day a week minimum, they had to log all their diet. The app also gave them personalized food scores and meal recommendations. So the app is constantly giving them feedback and kind of scoring their performance and encouraging them to increase the score that they're shooting for over the course of the trial. So clearly there was a lot more supervision, a lot more resources, and a lot more encouragement, more positive pressure for people to adhere to these diets and to try to, in general, clean up their diet. And also the awareness that you're getting this tailored diet for you specifically based on your physiology, these supposedly state-of-the-art thing, is pretty motivating, right? It can be pretty engaging. And in fact, what they found by the end of the trial is that the individuals going through the ZOE program, they reduced their caloric intake a bit more. Also, the caloric density of the foods they ate was a bit lower. So probably a little less processed food, a bit more whole foods. Unfortunately, the trial does not report physical activity changes. So we don't know what happened there. Because they're going through this exciting program, kind of cleaning up their diet, it's possible that they exercised a bit more on the side. We don't know. But this caloric difference and this shift from processed foods to whole foods already explains most of the results they reported. Now, it might seem to a lot of people like these differences between the groups in terms of the supervision and the engagement and the intensity of the interventions are not a problem. After all, we're comparing it to a control group. So the control isn't receiving any of this. We're basically looking at being on the app versus not being on the app, right? The average citizen is not on the app, is not receiving any of this help. So why is that a problem? So it really depends what question we're interested in answering. Basically, this trial shows us that a population that is involved in this program with this support that was supervised and encouraged to eat a healthier diet saw more physiological improvements. This is a compelling argument that being in a support system, that having some sort of program that you're going through helps. But not necessarily that this one helps, that there's something about the ZOE intervention or the ZOE personalized diet and algorithm that is special. Because the whole idea behind ZOE, the whole claim to fame, is this personalization of the diet. That they come up with a tailored diet for your physiology based on your blood work and your tests that works for you and not for the next guy, not for your neighbor, right? But this trial doesn't really test if this personalization factor offers any benefit. It's entirely possible that if you gave everybody the same diet, but with the same level of intensity and the same level of support, that you'd get the same results. So how could this be designed in a different way? Because it's easy to point fingers, but what we have to do is suggest an experimental design that is actually feasible, right? And that would be better. That's the trick. So the ideal trial design is to give the controls what's called a sham personalization. Basically, they both get a diet plan. They both get interactions with the app or an app. They both get the same level of interaction with the coaches, same level of logging, but the ZOE group gets the diet designed through the ZOE algorithm that's supposedly targeted to the physiology of each individual. The sham group gets a randomly generated diet. One benefit of that design is it allows you to blind the participants. So everybody thinks they're getting the state-of-the-art cool thing that was designed for them. They don't know if they're getting the real ZOE or the fake ZOE. So it really levels the playing field in terms of all these psychological and logistical aspects. And it isolates the effect of the ZOE algorithm, if there is one. So that's the ideal design. Second best would be give everybody the same diet, maybe the USDA guidelines or Mediterranean diet, something like that, but match the level of intensity, the interaction with an app, the logging, the check-ins with the staff, all that stuff matched. So that's in terms of the trial itself, the science itself. Now, going back to the question of funding that we touched on in the beginning, we don't dismiss a study on autopilot just because it's funded by industry. It's very tempting to do that because it's effortless, right? It doesn't require reading anything or understanding anything. We can just say, oh, this trial is funded by industry. For me, it doesn't exist. But that doesn't really deliver any insight. So we actually have to go through this slog of scrutinizing the experimental design, the science itself. And if the trial is solid scientifically, it's always going to rank higher regardless of who paid for it. And if there are flaws to the design, it's always going to be downgraded, so to speak, regardless of where the money came from. So it always hinges on the science. Bottom line, I think the ZOE idea, the concept is really cool. We're all different physiologically, so why would we eat the exact same diet, every one of us? Find the diet that's right for you. That makes total sense. But is the science there yet? Do we know enough to design a diet tailored for one individual that actually delivers meaningful benefits? That's the question. Of course, this is all extremely marketable and extremely popular because we all want something that's made tailor-made for me, right? We don't want cookie cutter. And ZOE charges a premium for this appearance of personalization. It's not a cheap app. It goes for $59 for a month or $350 for a whole year, plus another $300 for the initial tests. So it's not cheap. Now, if ZOE is the real deal, and if this algorithm delivers a diet tailored for your physiological needs that gives you benefits that you can't get with other diets, then I think it would be worth the price tag. But currently, we don't have evidence supporting that it does. That doesn't mean it's useless. Obviously, it delivers some benefits compared to having no or much less support system, but it's entirely possible that you could get the same benefits with a much cheaper option as long as there is some support as well, app-based or not. Here's a lot more on precision, nutrition, this idea of finding the right diet for you, and here are some key concepts to put together a winning diet that fits your personal preferences. Check those out. I'll see you over there. Bye-bye.